Chapter 3, Energy, Chemical Reactions, and Cellular Respiration, Part 2. Enzymes. Enzymes are critically important to living cells and living beings. Enzymes are catalysts that accelerate normal chemical activity. So there's a chemical reaction. It occurs at a certain slow pace. Add your catalyst, in this case enzymes, that will speed up the production of the product. So it occurs faster. Occurs at the speed of life. And during this process, the enzymes are not used up. So the enzymes can be reused again and again and again. The way enzymes do this is they decrease what's known as the activation energy, the hurdle to get from the substrates to the products. And in living things, enzymes are usually proteins. There's some exceptions, but we're not going to worry about the exceptions. So again, here is showing a chemical reaction where we got sucrose becoming glucose and fructose. Normally, sucrose will become glucose and fructose all on its own, but it has a huge mountain of activation, energy of activation needed. And so it takes, thousands of years for sucrose to become glucose and fructose. Way too slow for us humans. So we have an enzyme, sucrase, that can lower that activation energy. So it becomes just a little speed bump. So we go from sucrose to glucose and fructose in milliseconds. Much better. So enzymes, the way enzymes work is they have a specific shape. That shape is critical for their function. And in that shape, they have an area called an active site. And this active site will only fit its specific substrate or substrates. So one active site, very specific for one or whatever the substrate or substrates is. So they are the things that fit into the active site, the only things that fit into the active site. Then this will lead to an enzyme substrate complex. During this step that the energy of activation is decreased, leading to products being formed and released by the enzyme. So again, shape is important. The shape of the enzyme determines what its substrate is. This is often referred to as the lock and key model because you need the right shaped key to fit into the right shaped lock. So enzymes are very specific, only work for a specific reactant or reactants. So for example, we have enzymes that stay in the cell. So DNA polymerase is an enzyme, boom, 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 that helps to make more DNA. We have enzymes that are embedded in the plasma membrane of cells. So for instance, lactase, that enzyme that breaks down lactose, is found embedded in the walls of the small intestine, cells that line the small intestine so that they can break down lactose in our digestive tract to form its monosaccharides that then can be absorbed. And then some enzymes are secreted from the cells. So pancreatic amylase breaks down carbohydrates, starches. So the pancreas produces them, releases them into the small intestine to break down carbohydrates. So again, going back to lactase, here's lactase. It has a active site that will bind lactose. Lactose is a disaccharide with two monosaccharides together. The enzyme substrate complex is formed, activation energy is reduced, the bonds break, and now release the products of glucose and galactose, and lactase is ready to act again and do this again and again and again for as long as there is lactose present. This kind of process, this chemical reaction going from lactose to glucose and galactose is known as a catabolic reaction or decomposition reaction. And it's probably hydrolysis as well. All right, cofactors. Cofactors are other things the enzyme needs to function. Some enzymes need cofactors. Other enzymes are independent of cofactors. So here we have an inactive enzyme, add its cofactor, now it is a happy active enzyme. Non-protein, organic or inorganic structures can be cofactors. If it's organic, then it's often called a coenzyme. Examples of these coenzymes are including many of the vitamins we consume. Inorganic cofactors on the other hand, are frequently metal ions like iron or copper or magnesium, sodium, lots of examples of those out there. So, different classes of enzymes. Oxidoreductases, surprise, surprise, cause oxidative reduction reactions, redox reactions. So, transfer electrons from one substance to another. Don't really need to worry about the examples, it's just there to let you be aware of an example. Transferases, transfer a functional group from one thing to another. This is the type of exchange reaction. So the transferase can take a monosaccharide from one disaccharide and add it to another disaccharide to give us a trisaccharide, well, technically correct, and a monosaccharide. So transferases, move functional groups. Hydrolase splits water. So catabolism reactions have often hydrolases to break back the water and often do other things as well. So here's some examples. Isomerases converts a molecule from one isomer to another. So for instance, glucose can be affected by glucose isomerase to turn it into fructose and backwards and forwards. And then we also have ligases that bind two molecules together. So anabolism reactions involve this, and lyases split chemical bonds in the absence of water. Absence of water, presence of water, absence of water. So basically know these enzyme classes and their basic description. You don't have to worry about the examples per se. All right, enzymes function at a particular rate, a particular speed in converting the product substrates into the products. And there are various conditions that can affect the reaction rate. So for instance, the concentration of the substrate, the thing being acted on, you can increase the concentration of the substrate and keep increasing it, and it will cause the reaction to go faster and faster and faster until you reach saturation. So if you have 100 enzymes, once you have 101 substrates, you have now reached saturation, so it can't go any faster, and it's sort of maxed out. So increasing the concentration of substrate increases until you reach saturation. Temperature can also affect the reaction rate. So basically the way it works is there is an ideal temperature that an enzyme functions at. Increasing temperature until you get to that optimal temperature will cause increase in reaction rate. However, if you continue to increase the temperature, then the reaction rate will go down until eventually the temperature gets high enough that it causes denaturation and the enzyme doesn't work anymore. So basically, as it says over here, increasing temperature will increase reaction rate until you get optimal temperature. Further increase will decrease reaction rate until you get to denaturation. And what's the optimal temperature in the human body? That's right, 37 degrees Celsius. pH works a lot like temperature. You have an optimal pH for any particular enzyme. If you increase the pH past the optimal rate and keep increasing it, the reaction rate will decrease until finally you denature the enzyme. Or if you go the other way, you keep decreasing the pH, making it more acidic, that'll slow down the reaction rate until finally you denature the enzyme because it's too acidic. So pH extremes denature the enzyme. You want to function at the optimal pH. That's the optimal fastest reaction rate. Inhibitors are chemicals that can bind to enzymes to prevent the enzymes from functioning. A common inhibitor is the product. And so that if you have an overproduction, tons of product present, this can then bind to the enzyme and inhibit it because, hey, you got all the products you need, why make more? Competitive inhibitors. Competitive inhibitors are similar in shape to the substrate, and so competitive inhibitors will bind to the active site of the enzyme, preventing the substrate from binding there. This will decrease the amount of reaction occurring because the wrong thing is binding to the enzyme. So what would be the effect of increasing amounts of substrate when you have competitive inhibitors present? Will it increase catalysis decrease catalysis or have no effect. Hope you thought about it. It will increase catalysis. So you keep adding more and more substrate, that will become the most dominant chemical present. So the competitive inhibitor is not getting to fill those slots. It's diluted out by all that presence of more and more substrate. And you also can do the reverse, add more and more competitive inhibitor, and that would slow everything down. All right, non-competitive inhibitors. Non-competitive inhibitors bind somewhere else on the enzyme. They bind to an allosteric site. When the non-competitive inhibitor binds to the allosteric site, it changes the shape of the enzyme, changing the shape of the active site, meaning the enzyme cannot function. And shape is critical to enzyme function. So what would be the effect of increasing amounts of substrate in a reaction in the presence of a non-competitive inhibitor? Increased catalysis, decreased catalysis, no effect. Turns out it is, no effect. Adding more and more substrate has no effect on whether the non-competitive inhibitor is bound to the enzyme or not. So you can add all the substrate you want, it's still not going to affect how much reaction is occurring. In our complicated cells, in our complicated bodies, we often need many enzymes to go from the starting substrate to the final product. These are referred to as metabolic pathways. So it's a series of enzymes that need to keep reacting to the substrate as it changes and changes and changes to finally get to the next and final product. So for instance, you have substrate. It binds to enzyme 1. It changes to the triangle. Triangle binds to enzyme 2. It turns to the square. Square binds to enzyme 3. It turns into the hexagon. Hexagon binds to enzyme 4, giving us the oval, which is the final product. So you have a metabolic pathway of four enzymes to go from the substrate to the product. And then, often, the product acts as an non-competitive inhibitor that binds to the allosteric site, because if you have plenty of product, you don't need to go through this process anymore. Why waste the resources, right? What happens if reactants if product accumulates? They decrease. What happens to the reactions? The reaction rate will slow down. It decreases as product accumulates. Multi-enzyme complexes are where the enzymes are all bound together. And these enzymes are all basically in the same metabolic pathway that keeps them together. So the substrate comes in, binds to the active site, changes until finally you get the product. And that way substances were less likely to diffuse away. Best to have everything happening in the same place. Here's an example using robots to represent the enzymes. Regulation of enzymes can also occur by phosphorylation or dephosphorylation. Phosphorylation is adding a phosphate group to the enzyme. This often occurs by a protein kinase, adds the phosphate group. And this can turn the enzyme on or turn it off. You can also have dephosphorylation, that's removing a phosphate group from an enzyme. These occur performed by phosphatases, and the removal of a phosphate group may turn the enzyme on, may turn it off, it varies. So here, enzyme becomes active when the kinase gets that phosphate group added to it. And that is it for this part of the lecture.